Now, this is a special video. I was preparing for my 5th February course, like PMP course. I was making it. Then I thought, why not give it back to my community and share a little bit, or I would say a summary of what we are going to cover in that program. So in this video, I will try to cover the exam content outline with how you can understand the complete PMP. Now, in order to understand the PMP, we need to know few things. The first thing is that the PMP covered two major things, two major areas. The first area is, of course, predictive. That is 50% of the exam. The second area is agile. That is also agile, or you can say it hybrid. That is also 50% of the exam. Now, in predictive, what is basically predictive? In predictive, actually you give delivery. You delivery in one time. Let's simplify the things. In predictive, you give delivery only once. You make a complete object and you give the delivery. The scope is fixed. The time and cost are secondary fix. What do I mean by secondary fix? You cannot change the scope, but you can have a slight tolerance in time and schedule. Okay, now if you take example of this, let's say you are building a house of 200 or 400 square feet. You cannot have a tolerance when you are building a house, like you ask for 10 rooms and now you have 4 rooms because they have changed the scope. No. Once you give a contract, most probably fixed price contract to any contractor, the scope is fixed. You need these many rooms in your house. That's fixed. So that's more of a predictive environment where scope is fixed and you get delivery at one time complete. You don't get like the house is still in construction, but you can shift in one room. No, that does not happen. You get the complete house, one package. So that's basically all about predictive environment. So we, apart from these constraints, constraint is anything that limits you. We have quality, we also have risk, we also have resource. These are the some of the domains we you need to focus. While talking to agile, considering agile, we basically have this inverted triangle in which scope can be flexible, the time or schedule is fixed, the cost is fixed. The quality is also kind of fixed because we try to give the best quality to the customer. We try to give customer the most value. So the quality is fixed. What do you mean by scope is flexible? Do you mean that you don't deliver the scope complete? No. Most of the time people think that we don't deliver. No. The thing is that you deliver them minimum viable product. We give fast delivery. Let's say now we are making a mobile phone, let's say iPhone 12 Pro Max, iPhone, Apple, laptop, anything. You are making anything in softwares or you are making a website. First, you give them a feature that will sustain, that they can show to the market, that they can say, okay, this is my minimum viable product. For taking the iPhone example, maybe you can, at the end of first iteration, you can show them a design, that this is the design of iPhone that we are going to give you after 6 months. Now, we haven't given them a physical product, but we have given them something that is minimum marketable feature, minimum viable product. So in Agile, we try to give the product maximum by maximizing the business value by giving minimum viable product. If I'm making this chair in Agile environment, what will be the minimum viable product? Only my seat. Now, since this is a medicated chair, so if I'm giving a minimum viable product, maybe initially the design can be a minimum viable product. Maybe only my seat with these 4 legs can be a minimum viable product in first iteration, and so on. So it is important to know when you are doing the project, which methodology you can use and why to use that methodology. Okay, let's go to a little bit basics of it, how we reach to here. Now, projects are temporary endeavor. As we go to definition, projects are temporary endeavor, and as a result of project, you create some services, results, output. They are temporary. This is very important to understand. Operation, whereas they are not temporary, they are fixed. So how projects are selected? Let's go there. The need assessment. A need occur in the organization. Now the need can be by some stakeholder identified it, a customer asked for it, there can be a new law and all those things. A need occur. You do need assessment by utilizing SWOT analysis. What are the strengths, weaknesses, opportunity, and the threat of the organization? Through that, you make a business case. Business case is a documented feasibility study of cost and benefit analysis, where you see what is the payback period. What is the payback period of something? Like how much time it will take to deliver that product. What is return on investment of that thing? How you will get start return of that investment? What is present value and what is future value? Generally, we calculate future value as with this formula. 1 plus interest rate into number of years. So you can use this formula. Then we have IRR and we also have net present value. So these are some of the things that are known as selection methods for the project. If you go to exam content outline, you will see selection criteria for the project. These are some of the things. Also, you can use scoring model. In scoring model, you make a multi-criteria matrix. Like, what is the multi-criteria matrix? In a simple layman words, if you want to have a dinner somewhere, what is your criteria? You want to have best quality food, you want to have cost effective, you want to have quality to cost effective, you want to have hygiene environment. Maybe the first criteria can be that environment is if you are a family person or if you are going on a date or whatever the thing is that you want to look for the ambience. So this becomes a multi-criteria. So you rate them from 1 to 9, like this points, you point them and add them. This is called as scoring model. So you see all these things and going through that, you select which project to do. We have multiple options. Let's say we have 3 options. We use all these techniques to select which options we should follow. Once you have selected it, you go to detail of the business case. You make a complete business case, show the organization and see that business case is aligning with the organizational strategy. So once the business case get approved, you make a benefit management plan. Benefit management plan is basically, you can say it's a subset of a business case because business case gives us benefits. So we take benefit from that and make a complete benefit management plan. In program management, we also make benefit matrices. How you can measure what are the benefits, who is the benefit owner, how you at the end of the project, we can see that these benefits have been realized or not. So with the help of these benefits, finally, you make a project charter. So a project charter is formed in which basically this gives a formal authority to the project manager. This gives the formality that now the project can be started. Now with this, after this charter, now your project can be started formally. So you need to know how the project charter is created, and you also need to know what is the organization in which you are doing this project. Is it a projectized organization in which the project manager has complete authority, or is it a functional organization in which functional manager or operational manager has complete authority? Then you need to see if it is a matrix organization, like the responsibility is shared between both parties. As an exam point of view, unless it is mentioned, it is a projectized organizational or it is a functional organization, always consider it's a matrix organization. So once we know that, we also need to know that do we have a PMO, project management office? If we have a PMO, what is the level of PMO? Is it a supportive PMO? Is it a controlling PMO or is that a directive PMO? So you need to know this supportive, controlling and directive PMO. Then you need to have a governance structure, how you are going to control the risk and all those things. Once this is done, you know in which your organization, in which environment your organization is operating. So let's, and you can never complete your environment of the organization unless you know about OPS, organizational process asset, the lesson learned document, the tool, templates, all those things. Lesson learned is very important here. Then EEF, enterprise environmental factor. It can be internal, your work authorization system, your project management information system, culture, customs, all those things comes under enterprise environmental factor. So once that is clear, the way in which your project is going to be built. So once again, a need occurred, a need assessment. We have this need assessment. From that need assessment, we see multiple options and we make a business case and see with these matrices, which business case, which option is better. We recommend that option and we make benefit management plan and we see in which environment your organization is operating. What are the enterprise environmental factor, internal and external? What is the marketplace condition? All those things. Then we see, is this organization is projectized? Is this matrix functional or organizational? Then we see how the governance is being done. What is the level of PMOs, supportive, controlling, or directive? Unless mentioned in the question, always assume the PMO is supportive. Once that is done, you make a project charter. Project charter is a formal document that authorizes the project manager. So once that is done, you have a high-level vision of the project. Then you identify your stakeholders. You identify your stakeholders, who are basically your stakeholders. All the stakeholders from all the documents that are currently available, you rank them on power interest matrix. So stakeholder having high power, high interest, you manage them closely. Stakeholder having low power, but high interest, low power, but high interest, you basically keep them informed. They have high interest to give them information. Stakeholder having high power but low interest, keep them satisfied. Stakeholder having no power, no interest, just put them on watch list. Once that is done, then the next step is basically putting a strategy for especially these stakeholders. What are their current engagement level? What are their current engagement level and what do you desire? So make a stakeholder engagement matrix to engage these stakeholders. And you also make a stakeholder management plan, a complete strategy, how you are going to change the current state of the stakeholder to the desired state of the stakeholders. Then you work on your project team. Then you look at your project team, all the resources. Now project team can basically consist of those people who are going to work. All those stakeholders are the part of project team, or the project team is also part of stakeholder. But we classify generally stakeholders as someone who is affected or who thinks that he can be affected by the project, and excluding project team. All the project team is the most important stakeholder, but generally we classified it this way. So once you are thinking about the team, you need to think like you are going to get physical team or you will have virtual team. If you are going to get virtual team, we will talk about physical team in a while, then you need to see what technology is available, how you are going to manage them, all those things. And once you are getting a physical team, you see, do we have a pre-assignment, how we are going to select, all those things. We are going to focus what the rates of both of physical and virtual teams are and how we can manage those rates. So these are the few things that you are looking for the team. Of course, you need to see about the diversity. Now, diversity is a very important topic. It contains like sexual diversity, male and female, both should be in the team. Cultural diversity, more diversity is there, the better it is. The first thing is accepting the fact that there's a diversity in the team. Then moving with the help of that diversity, how you can utilize that diversity in your benefit, in the benefit of project. So How do you do that? By understanding emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence is a very important topic in PMP. Emotional intelligence is a very important topic for your real life projects. What is emotional intelligence? It consists of basically four steps: knowing yourself, managing yourself, knowing others, managing others. So that's all about emotional intelligence, knowing your emotions and managing those emotions, knowing emotions of others and managing those emotions in the best interest of the project. Then you need to know what personality of every team member is that. Are they right side brain, the left side brain? They are more like technical, they are more visual, all those things you must understand. I'm not going to go into detail because let's move forward, but you need to know the personality of each team member. Then a very important thing to understand the stages of the team, how team occur, is Tuckman ladder. Tuckman ladder actually give us all the stages of team. Your team is first at, if I make a graph of this, let's say, pardon about my drawing, productivity, time. So initially your team is at forming stage. So when the team is at the forming stage, the team is unsure about the project. So when they come, what do you need to tell them? You need to communicate your vision of the project. What is the vision of the project? What does the project want to achieve? What is the goal of the project? How this goal goes the organizational strategy? You need to put ground rules. The ground rules are the basic rules that everyone must follow. Now, the team can make themselves the ground rules, or initially you can make the ground rules for the team. Then the team build a team charter. Now, team charter and project charter are entirely different thing. Team charter are the rules, regulation, values that teams are going to adhere. So all these things are there. And you here in the forming stage also identified skills required for each team member and current level of those skills and how you are going to give them those skills while moving forward. So forming stage is very important stage, and exam do highlight a lot of this in the exam content outline. Exam tells us how you are going to manage this thing, because a project team comes, you want to understand what is the composition of the team, what are the requirements of the team, what are the stakeholders. You identify, you list all the skill, RACI matrix, responsibility, accountability, consult, inform, can we utilize here. You go for team skills appraisal. You see if the team members have already worked with you in the past, can you give them some pre-assignment? Diversity is very important. And you get a resource management plan. The resource management plan that highlights how you are going to manage the complete team. Then you give responsibility to the teams. You give them assignment, how they are going to complete those things, all the works that is required to complete. A team charter is built, ground rules is built. And very important thing, you need to make an environment, a safe environment as a project manager to foster a relationship in which they can speak freely, an environment where they can work easily. The skills you need here are negotiation skills. They're very important to build between internal and external team members, understand codes of ethics of PMI. They are very important here. And if there are violation to the ground rules, you need to manage and rectify ground rule violations. You need to negotiate agreements with team member, like their rates can be negotiated, their working time can be negotiated, prioritization technique like MOSCO, dot voting, 100 points, that can be utilized here. Then you need to see how performance reports will be shown. Maybe you use information radiator, you use burn up, burn down chart, expert judgment, negotiation strategies there. And you need to see how you can make those agreements with the team members. Very important thing here, you need to understand in the forming stage, what are the strengths of the team members? How you can help them to build those strengths and how you can work with them, estimate them, guide them give them some decision authority. So all these things must be done in the forming stage. So a lot of things in the forming stage. So if I can run this. Now, very important thing at forming stage. Oh, I almost rubbed everything here. Okay, at the forming stage, the power or the authority, the PM is very high, and he need to also support the team members here. So the PM role is more of a directive here. He is giving directions to the team, what to do, how to do. So once the forming stage is passed, normally the next stage become storming. Storming is a stage where basically conflict occurs between the team members. Now here, where the you need to understand, is this problem of training, that there's a problem of training, you've identified the gap analysis, training need, options, all those things, and measure those trainings. Is the conflict is occurring because of lack of training, or is this occurring because of lack of communication? So you engage people, you make a communication plan, you implement the guidelines. This is particularly important for a virtual team, how you can share the understanding about the project, maybe through different kind of tools and technique that can be utilized in this area. But the very important thing is at this stage is to understand the conflict level. Understanding the conflict level, where actually conflict right now occurs from level 1 to level 5. Level 1 is disagreement. Level 5 is war. So you need to understand actually at which level the conflict is, and you handle the conflict according to that, and you try to get a win-win situation in all the areas how to handle the conflict. So once storming is passed, here the role of the project manager is more of a coaching. Here is giving high support and high direction. Here the support was low, direction was high. Once that is done, if I can rub this. Okay. So once the storming is passed, slowly, if this stage is managed in the good way, we start moving towards the norming stage. In norming stage, the team started understanding each other. Team started understanding the habits of each other. So here, basically, still you are mentoring them, supporting them. So support is high here. Now the direction is low. Team started understanding each other. At the next level, here again, communicating the project need, the project environment is very important. So next, you move to the next step, that is performing, ideal stage. Here you basically delegate the task to team member so that they can work by themselves. So once that is done, here low support, low direction. Once the project started completing, we move towards the adjourning stage. So this is the phases how the team passes. Now let's just have a high level look of some of the processes, some of the framework. Now new PMP exam content outline does not move toward any specific framework that you should follow this framework over that framework. Actually, it suggests all the frameworks. It suggests every framework is open. Being said that, Scrum is preferred in Agile. We'll talk about predictive in a while. Scrum is preferred. Scrum is a framework in which basically at the start, you make a product vision. You make a product vision, what the project want to achieve. Then you make a product roadmap. Like roadmap is a division of the project, step 1, step 2, step 3, utilizing maybe story map. Like it contains, let's say the timeline of the project is high level 1 year, high level that is mentioned in the project. So it will have, in the first quarter you will produce this, in the second quarter you will produce this, in the third quarter you will produce this, in the fourth quarter you will produce this. So release 1, release 2, release 3, high level breakdown of the work. We will have our roadmap. So we have 4 releases. From the releases, we divide the, let's take release 1, we divide the work further into smaller parts. In the user stories. Our user stories are actually written on these sticky notes. So we call that every user story have 3C card, this sticky notes, and it has conversation on it. So what the conversation is? Conversation is basically as a user, what is your role? A user, you are a stakeholder. I want, this is the need, so that. This is a measurable criteria. This is a conversation, and third thing is confirmation, also known as definition of done. So this is definition of done. So user story is a comprehensive thing in which everything is defined. There are some characteristics of a user story. They must be independent, they must be negotiable, they must be valuable, they must be estimatable, they must be scalable, and they must be time bound. So you can actually do that in the given time. So once all the work is divided into user stories, let's say we have 100 user stories, we put them like in the form of the deck. We call that deck as a product backlog. So for a complete project, this is important. We have one product backlog. We prioritize the product backlog through various techniques like MOSCO. It's a very important prioritization technique. Must have, should have, could have, would likely to have, but maybe next time. 100 dotting points, like the stakeholders come together and we give them 100 points and they can put the priority on the user story, which user story is more important. And you also have a technique known as prudent the tree. Yeah, that's a very good technique. Prudent a tree, in which we make a tree like this and we connect the branches of the tree to that, and we put the sticky notes which are the most important user stories for all the stakeholders. And on the side of the prudent of the tree, we make a board. Now this is a prudent a tree. This is a second technique. My drawing is actually not very good. And the board is moving towards the tree, and we'll see here, we use this technique to see what are the risks, what are the stones that can stop us from achieving, and what are the wins, what are the good things that can help us achieving this project. So we make a complete project or complete definition on the project. This actually can be utilized in the product roadmap also. So we prioritize through this by putting 100 points, by triggering MOSCO, green, red, yellow, all these techniques can be utilized to prioritize. So once you have a prioritized product backlog, that's a 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, who prioritized the product backlog actually? Product owner prioritized the product backlog with the customer. Considering high business value and high risk. You see, how do we know what are the high risk activities? In this boat, the boat is moving toward, this is known as a sailor boat. The boat is moving toward the work, the tree that you are trying to work, this tree that you are trying to achieve. We say that these are the risks, these are the stones that can stop us, and these are the winds that are the good thing that can help us. So we know what are the high risk. So we try to deliver high risk, high business value item first, then high business, medium risk, high business, low risk, and so on. So we prioritize all the things in this. Product owner prioritize it. Then the development team with the Scrum Master comes and they take this, they look at this prioritized product backlog, and in their sprint, which is actually a duration of 1 to 4 weeks, they start making sprint planning and they make sprint backlog. Now sprint backlog contain the user stories that the team think they can complete in that duration. Now this is totally on the team, which user story to complete, how many user stories a team can complete. A product owner cannot say that you should complete these many user story in that. This is actually a complete job of the team. Okay, but there is always a negotiation between the team. So we have a sprint backlog at the end of sprint planning. Now what happened after sprint planning, product backlog, sprint backlog, we start the sprint. Sprint is 1 to 4 week. We have sprint of 1 to 4 week. And daily, we have daily stand up here. Okay. So we have daily stand up here in this sprint, which we discuss what we did yesterday, what we are going to do today, and is there any impediment or roadblocks in the work. So Scrum Master facilitate this session, and this session is basically done in the co-located area where the team can discuss each and everything and where they can work to find out what are the best thing, what are not the best thing. So these are the very good thing. So we have information radiator where the stand-up is occurring. What are information radiator? Like burn up chart is showing your progress as you move down. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's say this is a 1 week sprint. One user story, 2, 3, 4, 5. As you move, how your progress is moving. So this is a burn up chart. If let's say a user story is added, it will show that a user story has added here. And if a user story is removed, it will show that. So it can also show us what are the changes in the product. So we have burn up chart. Similarly, we can also have burn down chart. Burn down chart basically shows the complete progress, and it shows the work in descending order. In descending order, we can also have burn up chart. These are burn up chart for progress. We can similarly have burn up, burn down chart for risk burn down chart, showing how risk are moving downward. So if the risk are not moving downward, this means we are not removing the risk from the project. So we have burn up, burn down chart. We can also have task board showing the progress to do, in progress and completed. Like how many user stories are there in to do, how many are in progress, and how many are completed. Now very important thing, if you put limit here, let's say at one time 3 user stories or 4 user stories can work in one progress. So you have limit work in progress here, then the task board become Kanban board. Kanban board, you will get a question regarding what is Kanban board. Kanban board basically shows you the progress, and it has work in progress limit. What does this mean? The work in progress limit shows that you can only have these many user story at one time. That's it, not more than that. Okay, so it actually builds a pull system. Let's say you are working on 3 user story, 1 user story is completed, this user story is moved there. So then you will pull another user story from here to here. So you will have 3 user stories here now and 3 user stories here, and you will have additional user story there. So it works on the pull system. So how the Kanban board works, it first step, it shows the complete progress, then it limits the work in progress, then it establishes the flow, it makes the policies how to make this work, and you keep on doing that. You can make this, or you can make on demand scheduling. So with the help of Kanban board, actually we can make cumulative flow diagram, CFD also known as. What is cumulative flow diagram? It is just showing you how much has been done. Okay. How much is in progress? Okay. And how much is left? Work remaining. Let's say this is done. This is done. The green area and yellow area is remaining, and this small one is in progress. So in the similar, easily you by seeing this area, we know this is our bottleneck. most of the time work in progress is the bottleneck. So you can work on it and improve it. So you get task board placed in your daily standups, burn up, burn down all this information radiated, and you prefer to team, have a co-located team so that you can have osmotic communication. That this means they can overhear each other. So you daily have daily standups, and at the end of 4 weeks, the customer come and you show them in sprint review. You show them minimum viable product. You basically give them the demo. Now the demo can be in the form of wireframe. Now all these things, all the models I'm making, they are in the form of wireframe. Wireframe is a low fidelity prototype. Like if you're making a website, you show them the sketch, all those things. You give them the demo. You show them how many user stories have been completed, and they accept the user story according to the definition of done that was agreed in the sprint. Then the if there is a, some change in the change in the priority, you reprioritize the product backlog. You reprioritize the product backlog. So that's all about sprint review. Once the sprint review is done, that customer goes, then the team sit together. The teams sit together, and that is called as sprint retrospective, in which team discuss each and everything with themselves. So in sprint retrospective, basically you look at your processes and you see how you can improve. Scrum Master actually facilitated. It has 5 stages. Set the stage. In the set the stage, we actually want people to open up so that they can share the ideas. This is a very important thing. Here, rapport is being built that people can talk, they can open your mouth, they can basically discuss the ideas, and everyone can get the equal opportunity to discuss the idea. We use various techniques. One very important technique is ESVP, Explorer, Shopper, Vocational, Prisoner. Like we give each person sticky notes. Sticky notes are actually very used in sprint. So we give these sticky notes to people, and they go through those sticky notes and they write them. What the purpose of their coming to this meeting? Are they explorer, like they are trying to explore all the ideas, or are they shopper? They will be happy with the one idea. Are they vacationer? They are happy to be away from their work. Are they prisoner, like they have been sent there and they don't like that? So once that data is collected, the data is shared with the team. Of course, this is anonymous technique. We don't share actually what is happening. Okay. But we don't share who said that I am explorer, shopper. Okay. So when the stage is set, people are comfortable, we gather data. The second step is data gathering. We gather the data. We can use brainstorming here to gather the data. We use timeline technique here. Like we make a timeline of all the days, day one, day two, and we set the mood as how do people feel about it. Sad, they are not happy about that event. Mad, they are like, or glad. We categorize those events and we gather the data. Then we generate insights at step number 3. Of course, for generating the insight, we use 5Y and Ishikawa. Brainstorming can again use there. Then we decide what to do. Step number 4 is decide what to do. We make SMART goals, specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, time-bound goals in here. We make basically what we should do, what we should stop, what we should do more, what we should stop doing, what we should start doing, and what should we keep on doing. All these metrics are there. Then at the end, we close the sprint. And we ask people to rate how they feel about the sprint. What was good, what was bad in that sprint? So what could be improved? What is their hypothesis? What they learned in this? How they feel? They rate it in plus and minus delta. Okay. So that's a basically general things about sprint or scrum that you need to know. Then we have XP. In XP, 2 people are working together, 2 programmers. They are working side by side and they are doing programming. This person is doing programming and he is looking at them. We call this as pair programming. reason is that if this person make up a problem, he can easily catch. So here courage is required. Openness, the three values of agile: inspection, adoption, and transparency is very important there. So once the code is done, we test it with the code in the test-driven development. In test-driven development, with already built server and see through continuous integration, is this working or not working? And we talk and see how we can do these things. In XP, basically these things happen. Then we have lean. Lean is very important. Agile is a subset of lean. We have 7 ways of lean, and we have like some principles of lean. You try, the purpose of lean is to eliminate waste. Identify the waste, eliminate the waste. How do we do that? We make value stream mapping. We make map of the complete journey, and we try to decrease cycle time. This is the purpose of lean. So we have lean, we have Scrum, we have discussed Kanban board, we discussed value stream mapping. So I think that's all about you need to know about agile methodology. Then we move toward the predictive methodologies. So we already know how basically we do scope in agile. In predictive, we make 3 baselines: scope baseline, schedule baseline, cost baseline. We have different estimation techniques for agile and predictive. Like in predictive, we use analogous estimation, same. Like if you make a 200 square feet house and you again want to make a 200 square feet house, that is analogous. If you want to make 400 square feet house, that is parametric. Then we use three point estimation: optimistic, pessimistic, most likely. And then you also use bottom up estimations. You do reserve analysis with contingency reserves and management reserves. And in agile, we use basically estimation techniques like planning poker. We use affinity estimation. We estimate the stories on the basis of Fibonacci series, like 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13. In Agile, all the techniques, affinity estimation, wideband Delphi, planning pokers, t-shirt sizing, all are a relative estimation. We don't do like actual estimation, we do relative. Let's say if this is this, then what will this? We compare those things. These are some estimation technique. We also in Agile, we do refactoring. We keep on improving the quality that we will discuss in the quality area. So scope, cost, time is done. Then we manage the risk. How do we manage the risk? We know about Agile. In predictive, we plan risk management. We identify the risk. We rank the risk through qualitative risk assessment, probability and impact matrix. Then we do quantitative risk assessment, the Tornado, Monte Carlo. Then we make plan risk response. We have negative strategies and positive strategies. Negative strategies as avoid, mitigate, transfer. Positive strategy as exploit, enhance, share. Then we have accept, active acceptance, passive acceptance for both positive and negative. And then we have escalate and how to escalate. That is very important to know. All those things are there. Then we have contingency plans for the active acceptance, and we do risk assessment this way. Then how do we do procurement? Procurement is mostly done even in the agile methodology through predictive way. What you do in procurement, you identify whether you may want to make it or buy it. Then you identify the potential sellers who can do that, and you categorize, you make a criteria, you make a statement of work, you send, advertise your product, what do you want to have, you get the proposals. You select the proposal, you select the seller, you may sign the agreement, and then you do inspection and audit. Once the procurement is complete, you do the close of procurement. So quality, then you are also checking their quality standards, you are adhering to the quality and all those things. So I have tried to cover the complete PMP or the summary of PMP in this video. I hope this has been helpful to you. If you have any follow-up question, feel free to ask me at any time. I would love to share whatever I know with you. Thank you very much. And till next time, stay legendary, stay happy.